Before we begin this interview, I want to make you completely aware that this will be televised on KCM and Facebook and YouTube once I get that channel going.
Okay.
Is that good with you?
Fine.
Absolutely.
Super.
Consent we have. Welcome to Progress Not Perfection. My name is Della and I have a very special guest today, Mr. Robert Powell.
Hi, Della.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good. A little tired. Been working hard on the show, but very excited about it. Yeah. I'm happy to have you here.
I'm happy to be here.
You have a very deep voice. Where are you from originally?
I'm originally from a place called Clayton County. It's just north of here.
Is it in Tennessee?
Yes. Little subdivision called Harriet. But most people know it as Powell Valley.
So. Powell Valley.
Yeah.
Robert Powell from Powell Valley.
Sure.
I like that. Well, what brought you to Knoxville?
Just a life change. I needed it. I needed to change my people, places, and things.
So your addiction began in Clayburn County?
Yes.
Is that what brought you to Knoxville, was treatment?
Yes. Okay, yeah.
How long ago was that?
I went to a treatment center about, 6 or 7 years ago.
6 or 7 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
So what led you to addiction, if you don't mind me asking?
I started smoking weed when I was around, 11 years old. I played football when I was younger in high school, middle school, high school, and I sustained some injuries and stuff, and that kind of put a beating on my body, when I got out of school, started working, of course, went to a factory, stood on concrete all day long, and it really hurt. It was killing me,
What injuries did you have from football?
Ankles, sprained my ankle multiple times.
And what position were you in football?
I was a right tackle and a defensive end.
I know it had something to do with tackle. Could you imagine seeing this guy on the field? I'm just saying. But please continue.
I was hurting one day. A guy came up to me. Offered me a Lorset 10, and my pain went away. I felt like Superman, and it just escalated from there. It slowly evolved over the years into methamphetamines. So
is that your drug of choice?
It definitely is. It was the love of my life at one point in time.
I can definitely relate to that. Again, that's my dog. I apologize. So, would you consider yourself a functioning drug addict, or did you resort to criminal activity?
For the most part, through the years when I was, smoking weed and pills, I was functioning. I had a house, had custody of my daughter. And then when I started doing meth, it changed me really bad. That's when I started stealing, and I was not proud of the person I was.
Did you lose custody of your daughter? Is that too personal?
I did. It was a really hard point in my life, losing her, but it was for the better, but today it's, I've never been closer to her, so.
That's amazing.
That's wonderful.
I'm very happy for you.
Thanks.
Do you have a picture of you and your daughter that you would like to show?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, let's take a look at that. So, I have to ask, have you ever been arrested due to your drug use?
Yes, I have. When I got on the methamphetamines, I turned to criminal activities, and my family done the best thing they ever done for me, and it was the hardest thing for them, but they kicked me out off the property, and I stopped. It was my fault. I stopped paying the bills, and you know, they was tired of me manipulating them, and so they started seeing me kill myself, so they handed me over to their faith, and you know, and my dad gave me he gave me a vehicle later on, and I started living out a bit, and it was okay, like for a while when it was summer.
Yeah.
And you know, I was a country boy and just a extended camping trip, and
yeah,
when winter hit, that's when it was bad, you know. And
I too have lived in quite a few vehicles, homeless, and I like the spring and fall areas. You know, it's not too hot, it's not too cold, and
mm-hmm.
but
that's when it wasn't so bad. And then you know, it was my family had been praying for me to get arrested, you know, and it happened. I was I think I was like 31, and I got arrested. I was sleeping in my vehicle, and the police had surrounded me thinking I was somebody else.
They surrounded you thinking you were somebody else?
Yeah, they were hunting for somebody and thought I was them, but I wasn't, and it turned out to be the biggest blessing that ever happened to me, you know, so.
So you were caught with drugs on you?
Yes.
Possession type thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, that unfortunately happens a lot, and I wish more addicts would understand that being arrested is not always a bad thing. So far, most of the people I talk to say that their arrests are a blessing,
mm-hmm.
and I, for one, can back that up.
Absolutely.
So what led you to recovery?
Oh, I was I was jobless, my house was a trap house, and a lot of people were staying with me at the time, and I just met this guy. And he came and stayed with me a few nights. And but this one evening, I was out on a run, and you know, got back home. Long story short, and unlocked my front door, and came in, and the guy had hung himself from my ceiling fan. And that was a big pain. It was shocking. It's okay. I've worked through it, but PTSD is real.
I suffer from PTSD as well.
Yeah, I have nightmares about it every year when it rolls around that time. But it was Overdose Awareness Month, and my family, of course, was super worried about me, and they started calling around, and all those numbers. The numbers on the TV, the hotlines and stuff, it, you know, they got me into a rehab facility here in Knoxville, and it started my journey, you know, so.
And for most of you that do not know, Overdose Awareness Month is in August, and Overdose Awareness Day is August 31st, and that will be a very special episode, and I cannot wait to film it. Have you ever relapsed since you made the first decision to be in recovery?
Oh, yeah, multiple times.
Have you?
Yes. When I first I left rehab and went back home, I think I got 8 or 9 months clean, and went back out. And that was the one time I went. I was doing it for the family. Second time around, I went to jail, got about a year clean, and got my paper signed Then I went right back out. And stayed out there only a few months. And it got real bad. And so it was, it come down to either putting, ending it myself or getting help again. And I asked my higher powers that day. I was like, either something happened here or take my life. And one of the friends I'd made in recovery down here messaged me that night out of nowhere and told me to come home.
Sign from above.
Yeah. And so I came back, and I've been at it ever since. And it'll be one day at a time, God willing, 3 years on March the 2nd.
March the 2nd, 3 years. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
I was going to ask you what your clean date was, but that's amazing.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit over 2 years, and
sweet.
Yes, I know. High five.
Yeah, that's awesome, man.
That was probably corny, but oh well.
Who cares? The human torch was denied a bear clone. How now, brown cow?
Do you ever have the urge to use now?
No. Fleeting thoughts here and there. I mean, I'd say that's normal, you know.
How do you, when those fleeting thoughts happen, what do you do?
You know, if it's bad enough, if I'm having a terrible day or something, I'll, you know, I'll take a breath, say a little prayer. And if it's that bad of a day, you know, I'll call somebody in my network and my sponsor. I'll call my sponsor. If my sponsor don't answer, which when he took me on as my sponsor, he said, I like to take naps and I'm not always available. So if you can't, you need a network if you can't get a hold of me. So if I can't get a hold of him, I have many people on my phone that I can call.
So you have a very good network.
Yes, my network is very strong.
A network is the people that you build around you, also in recovery, that are going to be right there by your side no matter what. If you need them, they will be there. So for any addicts that have no one, build a network. It is very, very, very important.
Yes.
What are some of your hobbies or things that you'd like to do now that you never did while you were in addiction?
Well, I like to play video games. I like Legos. It's something me and my sponsor does together. I like building things today instead of destroying them. Yeah. And music is my passion. I really enjoy singing, playing the guitar. You know.
Really?
Yeah. I've been a musician since I was 12 years old. Got my first guitar at 12.
Acoustic, electric?
First one was electric. I played Smells Like Teen Spirit until my fingers bled that night. You know, it's mostly acoustic these days now, though.
Well, do you have anything that we could maybe listen to or we could show Knoxville? Like, would you be willing to do that?
Yeah. I got a clip for you. It's Lady May by Tyler Childers. And you know, of course, I don't own rights to this music, but it's my cover.
So. Wow. Well, let's check that out.
Yeah.
Now I ain't the sharpest chisel that your hands will ever hit on. Darling, I can love you well till the road's gone. Now I've seen my share of trouble, and I've held my weight in shame. But I'm baptized in your name.
Absolutely mind-blowing. You have a beautiful voice.
Thank you.
And that's, so do you just play the guitar? Do you write songs?
Yeah, I write. You know, it's just, I don't know, it's mostly covers these days, but like I still write music and everything, and it's how I like to, it's an outlet for me, you know. And, I don't write journals or stuff like that. I've just always wrote poetry and song lyrics. And
I write poetry.
Cool.
Yeah, I actually wrote a poem about addiction while I was in jail.
And I wrote a song about addiction while I was in addiction.
Really?
So it's pretty painful. Yeah.
So, I don't know about Knoxville, but I know that I would love to have you get on the show to hear the song about addiction. So you got the words and the music and all that put together.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, but would you come back and play it for us?
Yeah, I can either play it for you or make a clip. I don't care, but I'll do whatever, man.
That's so exciting. Oh my gosh.
Play guitar.
So, what have you got to do in recovery that you've never got to do in addiction?
Many things. But my most memorable thing was getting to travel out west. And
you traveled where?
Out west.
It's a dream of mine. I don't know if I want to hear this story, but go ahead.
We drove out through Texas, down through Arizona, New Mexico, and all that, and out to California. Stayed in California for a little while with somebody that's in my network that, you know.
So you have recovery family all around California.
Absolutely.
And, you know, really cool. Addiction and recovery, it's all over the place. You know, addiction, I like to see it as a pandemic because it's worldwide. Mm-hmm. But you can also find recovering addicts, programs, meetings, and everything all over the world.
Yeah.
So, right. Out west.
Yeah, I went to some meetings out in L.A., and it was way different than here, but, you know, they got smoke breaks, and they clap and stuff like that, but I got to tell my story out there, which was really, really humbling, and it was so cool.
That's awesome. You know, I bet that was...
And my my brother in my network. He knows Danny Trejo, the actor, and
the Danny Trejo.
Yes.
Like Machete.
The Danny Trejo, the actor.
From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yeah. He invited me over to his home and fed me some of his famous tacos and showed me his really cool garage and with all his cool cars and
did he cook the tacos or?
Well, it's from his taco truck and his restaurant that he has out there in LA.
I did not know that.
Called Trejo Tacos, yeah.
It's pretty cool. I like that.
Yeah.
Once I go out west, once I save up the money, I might have to check that out.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, and it was good. It was really cool. The man's such a humble human being. You wouldn't be able to tell he's an actor. He don't act like one. But
yeah, because on TV, it looks like he's ready to drink beer and like kick your butt.
Yeah, he's a really good dude. Really good dude.
That's amazing. So was it like a sightseeing trip? Did you stop places?
Oh, everywhere. Oh, man. Vegas was amazing. Caesar Palace was so cool.
Were you good in Vegas?
I hit the slots once, come out positive, and I was like, that's it. I'm taking my money and I'm running.
Well, that's good. As long as you're good in Vegas. Yeah. That's all that matters.
I'm good everywhere I go. So.
Be good or be good at it.
That's right.
So, I have to ask, you said something about, did you say something about the Grand Canyon? Or?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, well, no, but I did go to the Grand Canyon. Man. And funny story, I'll tell you real quick. We drove up there, and we're spoiled out here in Tennessee because we get to go in the Smoky Mountains for free. Well, we drove up there, and I didn't know I was going to have to pay to see the Grand Canyon. And
really?
Yeah. I got up there, and luckily the ranger used to work out here in the Smoky Mountains, so he knew, and he was like, oh, y'all are spoiled out there. He was like, I'll let you in. And let you see it real quick before you leave. And
oh, that is so cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. And it was just the most majestic thing I ever seen in my life. There's nothing like it. You look at pictures and you're like, oh, it's rocks and it's a big canyon. But when you're there and you see it, it's a different story.
Did you ever think that you would ever see it in real life?
No. I didn't, and it's not the last time. I don't think it'd be the last time I ever travel like that. I'm actually making plans to go back out there this summer.
What about back home in Knoxville? Do you have steady work?
Yes. I'm welder, metal fabricator, and I absolutely love the work I'm in. It's art. It's art. And it's like, it goes back to the Lego thing. I love building things. I've always loved using my hands. And so I've just been blessed with a really good gift and like I just put it to use. You know, it started, I used to be carpenter and then it evolved from wood to metal. And so, I don't know, it's just something about seeing that metal melt and blend into each other and just creating a beautiful piece of art when you're done with it.
Everybody has a different message that they would give the sick and suffering addict. So what message would yours be to the sick and suffering addict right now?
My message is that there's hope and there is a promise of freedom. You just gotta want it for yourself. It's one thing I've learned that nobody, as bad as anybody wanted it for me, nobody could give it to me. I had to want it myself. And the help is there if you want it. You just got to go get it. And, you know, if you're in a program and you're working it and you mess up, that's okay. We all mess up. You know, and if you're new, just keep coming back. Just stay. And it will work. It will work if you let it. If you put in the work.
Yeah. That's beautifully put. Thanks. Beautifully put. So what do you think we can do as a community to better help the addict that wants to help but doesn't have the means to do so?
That's a good question. Really, I mean, if you don't have the money to, you know, help certain organizations and stuff, the biggest thing is donate some time to some people. Like, you know, the biggest thing is some people just want to know that you care and know that you're there and know somebody's there, because some people, you know, a lot of us go home to families and people, but some people don't have that, man. And all they want to know is that it's going to be all right and somebody cares. And sometimes that's more valuable than money, you know, so.
It's beautiful. Very well put. Well, I want to thank you so much for being on the show.
Welcome.
And I cannot wait to hear this song that you wrote in addiction about addiction.
I can't wait.
Super excited about that. We might save that for Overdose Awareness Month.
Yeah. Just
make a big theme out of it.
All right.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Well, my name is Della. I'm here with Robert Powell, and this was Progress, Not Perfection.
Hey.
We'll see you next time.